Thank you. teaching, restoring and building. With us, what belongs to God. Zion Global Ministries, Webb. Zion Global Ministries, Webb. Preaching, teaching, restoring.
Bless the Lord and good morning, and thank you for tuning in to Zion Global Ministries. We greet you in the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, and on behalf of our pastors Freddie and Marsha Piphus, we welcome you and we thank you for tuning in once again. And fathers, happy Father's Day. What a blessing to be a father. And I know we have surrogate fathers and uncles and grandfathers and mentors that have been fathers for so many different children, and I thank God for each and every one of you. This is your day, and I pray and hope that it is a good day for you. We're going to read scripture today from Psalms 150. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord is what Psalms 150 says. Praise God in his heavenly dwelling. Praise him in his mighty heaven. Praise him for his mighty works. Praise his unequaled greatness. Praise him with the blast of the trumpet. Praise him with the lyre and harp. Praise him with the tambourine and dancing. Praise him with stringed instruments and flutes. Praise him with the clash of the cymbals. Praise him with loud clanging cymbals. Let everything that lives sing praises to the Lord. Praise ye the Lord. Hallelujah. Let's pray. Father, I thank you this morning. I thank you for whoever's tuning in and whenever they tune in, whether they're in their car or in their home, wherever they are, Lord, I bless you for each and every person, each and every one who is tuning in right now. Something is going to be said today that I know is going to make a difference in their lives. So, Lord, I ask that they would just go out and be cyber evangelists and tell somebody, Lord, tell somebody to tune in with them and join in and listen in to this message today. I pray, God, that something not only will be said that will cause change, but someone's going to be set free and delivered. Someone's going to be saved today. So we extend salvation even now as you accept Jesus Christ into your life. That is what the number is for. So if you look at our screen and you see the number, I pray and hope that somebody will dial that number, Lord, and say, what must I do to be saved on this day? Lord, I bless you that this day is the day that you made, that you created. And Lord, we will not give you nothing but praise on this day. We worship you, King of Kings, Lord of Lords. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Now let's tune in and be blessed today.
Praise and worship is going to be a little different today. I found two videos on the internet that really, really just spoke to my heart. The first one is of a boy who's 10 years old, who's blind and autistic, and he is just expressing joy and gladness to the Lord, and it's just an awesome thing. He sings, "Open the eyes of my heart, I want to see you." And in this time where God is stretching us, I pray that that's your prayer. The next song hit me last week. It came as a result of hearing the testimony of my nephew Stefan's best friend, Kelly Richardson, as I was leaving their house last Sunday. She said, "Hey, I got something that I need to share with you." She said that her mom had been sick and hadn't had communion since March of 2020. And March of this year, she tuned in to our broadcast and had communion and continued to watch the service. And on the 14th, she passed away. And so Kelly wanted me to know that ours was the last service that she heard, the last worship, the last message is what her mother, Maggie Richardson, heard. And that really just, it touched me. So it says, I'm in my truck going home. This old song, "This May Be My Last Time," came to my mind. And I just kept singing it and singing it and weeping. And I thought, you know, it could be my last time in worship, but it also means, as I'm presenting, it could be the last opportunity that I have to reach somebody that is really, really in need of a word and worship. So it just changed my whole thought process of approaching worship. And to make sure that I got that information right, I just called Kelly. I wanted to make sure that I got everything right. And I told her what song we were going to do. And do you know what she told me? She said that she and her brother sang that song sang it to her as she approached her last days. "This may be my last time." We asked her if she would get on Zoom and share a testimony, and she said, I don't know. I said, you know what, God is talking to you, because a part of the vamp in this song is they say, I don't know. We never know. So today, be kind to whomever you come in contact with. Today, glorify God. Every day, give him the best you have, because it may be your last time. I don't know. You don't know. Enjoy the worship. Invite others to come in and participate with us. Yeah.
was asked to introduce Christopher and give a little bit of a timeline on his life. And it's hard to keep my composure talking about Christopher's story. But he was born in May of 2011. 2001. Thank you. You can tell him, he can do it better than I can. I have to go back a few years, yeah. And his mother was on drugs, Oxycontin and cocaine. And he was a nephew of ours. And we went down to Florida and took him out of the foster care system in August of 2002. And he's been a blessing to our family. And he loves to share his gifts. And this March, he was kind of discovered by the union leader and all the local media outlets in Boston. And he's been singing a lot of patriotic songs. But to back up a few years, when in 2004, Christopher was on his first mission trip with 8 Days of Hope. And at 4 years old, he went down to the front of the music ministry, and they handed him a microphone, and he sang the song he's going to sing tonight, Open the Eyes of My Heart.
Holy, 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 holy. No!
Hello, Zion family and friends. Thank you for tuning in with us. I'm so glad to have as our guest once again, Elder Lattier Hudson, our lead elder here at Zion Global Ministries, and Minister Shelly Webb, Pastor Shelly Webb. She and her husband pastor our Northern Kentucky location. And they've been helping me with our new series, Born to Win. They shared so much last week that I asked them to come back again for part two. And I gotta tell you guys that I received so many positive comments on the insight that you all gave last week. Your transparency blessed a lot of people. I had a college graduate to call me this week, and she really brought me to tears as she shared with me that she struggled with learning disabilities. Mm. And she's a member here. She wants to come on and share her story. Mm. And we had a grandmother to text us who has a son here. She's a member also. And she's wanting to share her joys and some of the challenges there. So thank you guys so much. The old folks used to say, you make one step, the Lord make two. And I tell you, God is really moving here. I want to go back to two questions that I raised in the first sermon and have you guys to talk it out with me. The first question I want to raise is, what does God think about the disabled? Dr. Shelly, what's on your mind?
Well, Pastor, again, thank you for allowing us to be here again today to continue the conversation. I think that, excuse me, God, who is love, and he clearly says it in his word.
Yes, he is.
That he loves the disabled. He takes something that folks would maybe dismiss and say they're not dismissive. They are human valued and worthy. And that agape love, that unconditional love, he says, is for everybody, not just for some folks, but the disabled too. I love them just like I love the prostitute, just like I love the drug addict, just like I love you. So God is clear about that. He loves the disabled because he is love.
Amen. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Praise God. Mm. Elder Lattier.
Yeah, that's a real conundrum, you know, to think about what God thinks about the disabled, and knowing that, as Dr. Shelly said, that he is love, and so anyone that comes into this earth realm has been sent from heaven to earth. Mm. Doesn't matter who you are, knowing that whose you are is purposeful. So you came here on purpose. Mm-hmm. If he said it to Jeremiah, he's no respecter of person, then if he said, before you were formed, I already knew you. So to understand that there are people that are being born that seemingly are disabled, which is not abled in some way, shape, or form, means absolutely nothing, except for that's just how they are. And if I love them, then you love them. Mm-hmm. And when Paul spoke about the least of these, and also so were some of you, in the sense of, you know, debauchery or drugs or drunkenness or whatever, and that God loves you as you are, bringing you out of darkness into light. Yes. I know that a disability we have probably put into a box of what that really is, mm-hmm. but it's a little deeper than that.
It is deep, and mm-hmm. I'm hearing the both of you say that all are gifts from the Lord,
yes.
To be valued mm-hmm. by us. Mm-hmm. Hear the word of the Lord from Psalm 139, verse 15 and 16. Mm-hmm. My substance was not hid from you when I was made in secret and curiously wrought in the lowest parts of the earth. Thine eyes did see my substance, yet being unperfect. And in thy book, all my members were written. So, again, to your point, God had us in mind before we came to the earth. He knows our days. Every second of it. And we just got to learn how to value life.
Yes.
Our struggle is wanting to be God. And if we were God,
Lord help. Yeah. Our love is not unconditional.
No.
His love is unconditional.
Yes.
Our love can be conditional.
Everyone, and that's powerful. Mm-hmm. And everyone, if we were God, would be some kind of perfect in mm-hmm. in our eyesight. Mm-hmm. But that's not the gospel.
No.
I read something from Joni Erickson Tada that's so powerful. It's from a clip that I want Zoe to play, but I don't want you to miss these words. Mm-hmm. Listen to what is said here. We live in a profoundly broken world. Mm-hmm. Every one of us needs the grace of God. Mm-hmm. And this is the part that I really love. The gospel is humbly admitting our inability, our brokenness, and our helplessness before God. And in so doing, we'll see that the body of Christ is made whole by the disabled, whose weakness and brokenness mirrors our own. Mm-hmm. So God, in his incredible wisdom, knew exactly what he was doing to make us whole.
There's a process, we know that, to get us from to. And every time we come into the earth realm, obviously you don't come in perfect. So if not, then
none of us do.
You have to be taught, you have to be raised, you know, all of these things come along with it. So the value that we have on each other, the value that we have on ourselves, it matters in how we see someone else.
Yeah. We don't come in perfect, and we certainly will not leave
perfect. Mm-hmm. Pastor, I think of the scripture where the four friends carried
my favorite.
The paralyzed man
up the roof.
Whatever it took for them to get him to Jesus,
Dr. Shelley,
they were willing to do. So much so that they carved a hole in the top of a roof because it was crowded where Jesus was. But they were determined that their paralyzed friend that was in this current state was not going to end up in that same state. They wanted him to be near Jesus so that he could be healed. It's so interesting that we don't even know their names. We have no idea. We just know the title of the person. He was paralyzed, his condition defined by his paralytic state. But that love that you talked about earlier, how these four friends didn't look at his current state as being something that was odd or different or we can't do anything about this. They loved him so much so that they were willing to take him to the great physician, and they were willing to do whatever it took. And I love that story so much so.
Yeah, that story resonates with Elder Lattier. And I don't know if you all ever discussed it.
No.
But there's a triumphant circle that he is a part of. Share it with her.
Matt Carriers. We have a prayer group that we pray with every week. And it is an incredible time together. We call it Care and Share. But at the same time, you know, our intent was to pray for Pastor. But what has started to happen and have birthed from it is we're bringing people before the Lord. And so we said, hey, we're mat carriers for the Lord. And whatever it takes, the good, the bad, the ugly, whatever it takes, we got to get them in front of the Lord. We got to get them there.
That's so powerful and appropriate for this moment, because I believe that God is calling us right now to be mat carriers.
Yes, yes.
To do whatever we can to get people to the Lord. And what you're saying then, Elder Lattier, is that there must be a place in the church for these individuals. Mm-hmm. Shelly said it when that guy came down the roof. Debris everywhere. Jesus didn't stop and say, get him out of here.
That's right. That's right.
Saw faith in action.
Yeah,
critical.
Yeah. We see the gospel right there in action. Yeah. So is there a place for the disabled in the church?
Yes.
Why haven't we seen this? If God loves, as you said, the disabled unconditionally, if there are gifts from above, why have we closed the doors to the disabled?
I can share.
Please do.
You know, image means everything, especially to us. You know, I said a little earlier, God is no respecter of persons, but we are.
Yes.
And because we have an image, and the church really has an image, especially when you're trying to grow and you're trying to be and you're becoming, right? So certain types of individuals, you don't really want them to partake and participate. So your value, not that it's valueless, it's just not as valuable. So because of that, we do what we do. But it's sad because the world system is embracing and moving forward. You can go to Kroger, you can go to wherever, Walgreens, you can go, you'll see individuals, and there's different levels, but you can see folks with extreme handicaps and disabilities who are doing work on a regular basis, interacting with people on a regular basis, and they make money. These are for-profit organizations.
You're saying that while the marketplace is very progressive, the church is lagging behind because we're stuck on how we look?
sad. Yes, sir. But that's what I believe.
So Kroger's has no problem in putting an individual forth that may be broken in some way, but the church says we hide our broken, even the brokenness in ourselves.
Oh, Lord. Mm. Oh, boy. You done tapped in now, buddy.
Talk to me, Shelly.
I remember when Nathan wanted to be an usher or helping hands. And he was very serious. At first, I didn't realize how serious he was. And then he said, I would like to serve in that capacity. And I want to give a shout out to Miss Ella, because she said, absolutely. And she walked him through literally step by step what to do. How to stand at the door, how to greet people, how to pass the offering, everything. And he absolutely loved being a helping hands. So much so that if he were to pass it to Elder Lattier and Elder Lattier didn't put any money in, he would stand there. And kind of, he wouldn't say anything.
You know what to do.
But his behavior was like, why are you not putting any money here? And he looked forward to being in that position and serving in that capacity. He loved it. So we need more Miss Ellas in the church. That will see the potential in somebody and say, I will help you, I will walk you through this process so that you can serve. If this is what you want to do, we're going to help you to get there. And that's what we need the church to do. We need people like that to help those people who have special needs or maybe disabled to get there.
Miss Ella.
Amen.
Thank you. Thank you. You've made a difference in your word that we need more Miss Ellas to help everybody realize that they're valued.
Yes.
Let's talk about one other person who had a spirit like Miss Ella, and that's King David. He becomes king and he remembers the covenant that he made with Jonathan, and he wants to honor someone. Is there anybody in Jonathan's family that I can bless? And they say, yeah. Mephibosheth. Mephibosheth was dropped when he was 5 and it left him crippled. And over and over again, I can just imagine here, I can hear him coming to the table in the palace with his braces on and everything. But this time in my message, I saw Mephibosheth in a different way. And I had to admit in that first sermon how I was made to feel. It says in the 12th verse of chapter 9, 2 Samuel, Mephibosheth had a young son. Why are you laughing, Shelly?
It's right there.
Why are you laughing?
He's not supposed to have a son.
That's what I thought in my mind. Wait a minute. Isn't he disabled? You had a son? And all of a sudden, I'm in this position of judging him and wanting to pull back provisions that David has extended to him because I'm not looking at him as a whole person.
Yes, yes.
And that's what we do oftentimes to the disabled. Talk to me.
That's tough. It's really tough. You know, I'm a provider, so I have clients, and I've had various clients over the years, so 10 plus years, and even growing up, as I mentioned before, my second mom, you know, she ran two homes with folks with disabilities. And my experience in doing the work with individuals and taking my clients around others, the folks that you would think would understand or should have some compassion don't have the compassion and level of care that should be there. So it's judgmental. Mm-hmm. So I've been indirectly told, I don't know why you continue to support them from people in that community. Mm-hmm. So they want to put a person in a particular place. You know, you're helping them. It's helping them to get out of that place. That's not good. Mm-hmm. And I'm like, I don't understand. I thought this was about help. Mm-hmm. I thought this was about support. I thought this was about encouragement. And so I've seen it firsthand, the judgment piece. And especially when you've placed someone in a box that you believe can't, mm-hmm. you know, mm-hmm. defend themselves or speak on their own behalf and all that. And they begin to speak on their own behalf and defend themselves. It's like, no, you shouldn't be allowed to do that. You know, like, it's amazing. It's absolutely amazing. The community is not where it needs to be.
Yeah. Wow. Thank you for that. Mm-hmm. Shelly, your thoughts on that?
You know, in the back of our minds, we said, not that kind. That's off limits for that type of person. That's a judgment piece you talked about, Pastor. We say that in our minds. Not that kind. How could? What do you mean? You have a son and you are just what?
Lord have mercy.
Not. That shouldn't happen. That shouldn't happen. I was convicted of the same thing. I was at Kroger's and my bagger named Robbie, nice gentleman, Down syndrome. And I heard people around saying, congratulations, Robbie, congratulations. And I'm thinking, what happened? I said, Robbie, what happened? Robbie said, I got married. I said, what?
What?
But in the back of my mind, I'm saying, you know, how could he get married? And I was convicted of that. That's talked about earlier. Does God love the disabled? Yes, he does.
Yes.
In every way, in every aspect.
In every
not just,
way.
Not just what we think, but in every dimension that we can think of. He loves them. So much so that Robbie, a Down syndrome adult, got married.
Look at that. Look at that. Look at that. You know, guys, I think we are in a season of transformation. You talked about your challenge right now at the university, and God is stretching you, and he's stretching Elder Lattier, stretching me and this church. He's stretching our nation in this Juneteenth weekend.
Holiday.
It's now a federal holiday.
Yeah. In our acceptance of one another as truly being made by God.
Yes.
And gifted to us by God. So in this transformation, you know, I yield.
Amen. That's all I can do.
Amen.
It's just yield and offer up and say, God, have your way.
Yes.
Because he really is, he's up to something.
Yes, he is.
I tell you this, if you can keep the assessment piece in its proper place before judgment, because if you see someone in a valued place, not just for now, but always, because see, someone can be valued in a moment, but then when that moment is not there anymore, you know, you're not, and I don't care who you are, disabled or able, it doesn't matter. If you are considered as valuable in a moment, then it says a lot about the individual who's doing that. We all say myself. If I see you and I don't value you as a whole at all times, then that means I pick and choose how I treat you.
That's good.
We gotta be delivered.
Gotta
transformed by the renewing of our minds.
Yes.
Thank you for that. Mm. And on that note, boy, you just blessed me. I have nothing else to say. Thank you all for tuning in.
Praise
and
God.
Shalom.